Look, someone sent me a large box.
What's in the box? Yes! It's the laser disc of Return of the Jedi before they changed everything and added that stupid song.
Well, that's just for testing purposes. What this really is... Oh, wow, it's even got the owner's manual. The very, very, very rare Halcyon Interactive Laserdisc System. So this was a home Laserdisc system prototype from the company that created Dragon's Lair, right? And only 12 of these were known to be made, all prototypes made by hand, and only 5 are known to exist, and this is one of them. So this is a prototype video game system from the 80s that was meant to use laser discs. Do not bend. This must contain a laser disc. It does not. Yes, the LD700. The first laser disc player to use a laser diode, I believe. It's all very well packaged. What is this? A laser disc game? Oh, it's Thayer's Quest. Thayer's Quest was an arcade game. It was like a Laserdisc-based arcade game, and it was based off this hardware. So this would be the home version of it. NFL football. San Diego Chargers versus the LA Raiders. So most of those old school Laserdiscs, where Laserdisc players could take serial commands, I would tell them, you know, what to do. Oh, looks like the Halcyon's on top. Okay. It weighs almost nothing. I'll set that aside. Super rare. See, it's shielded for space travel. Oh my gosh. It's got the box. Oh my. Oh my. So a fun fact about this. This was actually, this project was requested by the first person who ever bought one of my portable Atari 800s, like 19 years ago. Wow, in the box and everything. Now this box weighs a lot. So from what I read, it's a Pioneer LD700 rebadged as Halcyon. Man, are Laserdisc players always this heavy? Oh, don't forget to remove the transit screw. Good idea. Oh, the transit screw probably locks the read mechanism in place so it doesn't get jostled when being transported. Okay, I disconnected the transport screw. Let's see if this thing turns on. Ooh. Oh yeah, I bought this laser disc long ago, just because the art was cool. Gremlins 2. This should... Do I have to push it back in manually? I guess I do. Okay, so anything on the TV? What's... Yeah! The main thing here is that the Laserdisc player seems to work, so that's good. Now, what I believe happened with most of these Laserdisc games is the console just sent signals, like command signals, to the Laserdisc player, and that told it how to jump around. Now, there doesn't seem to be a remote with the player, but that shouldn't be a problem with the Halcyon, although it does prevent us, unless there's some sort of drop down. No, it doesn't look like it. These are all indicators. Like, that was a CLV disc, constant linear velocity, so if you paused it, the screen wouldn't pause. But if you had a CAV, which is probably what all the video game discs are, then you can pause it. All right, so let's get Gremlins out of there.
Would you like some Anthrax? I think you'd love Anthrax.
The real mystery is the Halcyon system itself. It's very prototype-y. See how there's all these unused ports, and there's also scuffs that have been magic markered over. Now let's see what's inside. Here we go! Wow, what's all this for? They must have planned some sort of expansion module that would fit right here. See the screw posts and all these holes in the back. But then there never was an add-on feature, I guess. What would it have plugged into? Oh, there's a header there. Weird. Seems to be almost like two systems in one. All right, so we have a Motorola MC6803 microprocessor, what we would now call a microcontroller. Let's see, blah, 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 blah. It can access up to 64K of memory. It has on-chip peripherals, which a CPU wouldn't have had back then. Serial communication interface, parallel I.O. And programmable timer, on-chip RAM, 128 bytes. Wow. Yeah, so this is probably being attached to these two. I'm assuming these are RAM chips, but I'll double check. I haven't found a data sheet for these yet, but that's a 4K EEPROM. That's what has a sticker over it, so the window doesn't get erased through sunlight. The rest of this is all glue logic, although there are some peripherals over here on the left, which probably have to do with the speech synthesis. Yeah, so this is 8K, 8K, 16K static RAM. So if I had to guess, just based off proximity, this RAM and this ROM are probably mapped to this microcontroller. If you go down here, we have the Z80, always a classic. Looks like they got some buffers hooked up to it right there. Let's see, D27256, so that would be 32K, I believe. Yeah, so 32K, so 64K of program space, and then looks like another RAM chip there. That's the same. I wonder how they map that. Maybe they're doing bank switching. I should peel up that sticker. I should dump all these ROMs. Ha 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 ha. Dump all the ROMs. Okay, got it. All right, so this is a 32K EEPROM. This is an 8K EEPROM, and this is another 8K RAM chip. So that would all fit within the 64K address space of the Z80. I wonder why they have two different systems. Oh, you know what? I bet the Z80 is used for program, and then the Motorola is probably used for the voice synthesis stuff. Power supply. Okay, looks like this is a National Semiconductor microcontroller. And yeah, maybe it's driving the keyboard, which is this connector here. Which means this is probably your voice synthesis and voice recognition, if I had to guess. I can't find anything on these two chips, so we're just going to have to assume that's the case. Uh-oh, looks like someone had trouble with the IDC connector, which stands for it didn't connect. And they're like, just put some solder in. Yeah, that doesn't matter if the wire's the right gauge. All right, let's try to get this thing to do something. Ah, Thayer's Quest. There's even a map. Oh, and a keyboard overlay. How quaint. A keyboard. How quaint. All right, so apparently it's going to ask me for my name, just like in that video that's online. A couple things I noticed about the Halcyon. There's no power switch, so I assume it just turns on when I plug it in. And also, I don't see how any video would come out of it. It's just, the only thing it's sending over to the Laserdisc player is serial commands. So I would think that any voices I would hear would be over this headphone, microphone thing. It's kind of, I suppose if it sat flush, you wouldn't be able to pull it out. Oops. Okay, looks like it's a double-sided disc. Is it CAV? It doesn't say. I'm sure Laserdisc experts could look at the disc and tell me, but I can't. All right. Should I go for it? I'm just gonna plug it in and see if anything explodes. All right, here comes the Halcyon. Okay. That's interesting. I didn't hear anything over the microphone, but plugging in the Halcyon sent a command to eject the disc. Let's just see if we can run the Laserdisc itself. The Halcyon is unplugged. Ooh. You know what that is, don't you? Bit rot. I wonder, is it sending back commands to the Halcyon? Maybe I have to push play on the disc. Remember, this thing was never finished. Okay, I'm plugging in the command cable from the Halcyon into the Laserdisc player. Now I'm going to plug in the Halcyon. See, it sent a command to the Legitus player. Oh, wait, wait, this is just a microphone, because it's just one plug. So where would the audio be coming from? Like in the demonstration, it's like, please say your name. So maybe this thing doesn't even really work? Well, for Pete's sake, it's a faux, look at that. There's no speaker there. It's a faux headset. I mean, it's just a microphone. I highly doubt it's doing any sort of checksum to see if the disc matches the cartridge. I don't even know how it would do that. It's looks like it's stepping through these frames. These must all be separate tracks. I don't see a track indicator though. This must be some sort of voice training. Well, here we go. Thundercats, ho! That must be Thayer? Well, that's clearly the bad guy. Dead. Oh no, Zeus is dead! I am not the last Zeus Jedi. Now he's dead. Here is the manual for the Laserdisc. There's the money shot. The I.O. port terminal locations. Let's see, external control in, interrupt, external control in, external acknowledge out, RF out, video out, no connection, 11 volts out, but do not use it as a power source. Okay, I wonder if those are TTL level connections. I would assume they are. So, if we could find the command code list and the data packaging, we could send our own commands to the Laserdisc player. Or figure out if any commands are being sent from the RDI. Well, if it's sending out the video, I wonder if the RDI is meant to mix the video. No, I don't think it can, because I didn't really see anything on the RDI that would be able to mix video. I mean, I kind of expected to see like a TMS9918, you know, video chip on there, like the ColecoVision had. The reason I expected that was because it was really common in the early 80s, and that chip could actually take an NTSC or PAL video signal in and actually use it as color zero in the background. So you could actually, you know, put graphics over video input. That would have seemed really appropriate, but I didn't see such a video control chip in this. I was thinking about this thing as I was being woken up by my cat at 5:30 in the morning. And it says, all, this is the instruction manual for the Halcyon. It looks like it is using a pass-through from the Laserdisc player. So they want the Laserdisc player audio output to go into the back of the RDI Halcyon, and that's probably where they add the voice. But look, see, that would have been stereo in, stereo out, and maybe RS-232? That's the missing component in this, is the audio mixer. Oh man, look at this doozy! Halcyon uses a small amount of power at all times to preserve gameplay history and voice patterns. Translation, we don't have a battery backup. If you unplug the unit, you lose all your data. Which means it basically never turns off, but they couldn't say that because even in the 80s that would have seemed wasteful and unenvironmentally friendly. I'm gonna figure out the pinout from this Laserdisc player back to the IDC, the It Didn't Connect player. Let's see. So this is reversed of what's in the Panasonic manual. Let's see, video out. Now here's the results. It's probably kind of faint because I wrote it in pencil. But yeah, they have the external control, the external acknowledge, interrupt, external, positive 11 volts, which it says on the Laserdisc manual, do not use as a power source, but they might be using that to detect the presence or if the Laserdisc is turned on or not, right?
And even though this port does have video out, they're not using it. So, okay, so they're definitely not passing the video through the Halcyon, just the audio. So, it would have... I know some Laserdisc players have the ability to put text on the screen, but the Halcyon itself, yeah, would have no graphics capabilities, which makes sense because there's no graphics chips in it. I'm going to remove the circuit board, just take a look underneath, but look, there's a potentiometer right there. We believe these are the speech chips. I'm thinking there was some sort of mixer for the audio here, so I bet that plug right there has the voice on it. There's a video online, it's very 80s, of some corporate-y types demonstrating this machine. It's important to remember that a lot of that stuff was completely faked, bodged by the seat of their pants. I mean, for all we know, the two guys demonstrating it could have had foot pedals underneath the table. I know that sounds preposterous, but if you read the book, The Rise and Fall of Commodore, they talk about how they went to a CES, Consumer Electronics Show, and they had the Commodore 128 there, and it was overheating. So they had this, a pedal they could push, and it would blow, it would secretly blow cold spray onto the chips to keep it from overheating when they demoed it. So, yeah. Computer history is rife with such deception. And this thing wasn't even remotely ready for production. I mean, one of the big giveaways is there's no RF shielding on it. Oh, yeah. I was wondering where all the bodge wires were for a prototype. There they are. Yeah, I'm not so sure about the connector now. Most of it goes to the power supply. It's got two grounds and then probably a positive voltage rail. But I don't know, how else would you get audio off of this thing, right? The stupid synthesized voice. It's like, I am Halcyon. Notice how it has the word HAL in it? Yeah, we noticed. HAL was the computer in 2001. Yeah, we know. We don't care. That was a good movie, huh? Shut up, computer. Shut up, Wesley. I don't know why, but now I'm thinking of Wesley Crusher in the amazing Technicolor Starfleet uniform. How would that go? I'm thinking of Wesley and the amazing Technicolor Starfleet uniform. That's coming from over there, which is... I wonder if that might be your speech right there on that pin. How would that go? And when Wesley tried it on, he knew his Starfleet days were gone. His amazing clothing gave respect for the most... How did the original song go? And when Joseph tried it on, he knew his sheepskin days were gone. Such amazing clothing did the biscuit. Quite the smoothest person in the district. Okay, so it would be, and when Wesley tried it on, he knew his Starfleet days were gone. Such amazing clothing gave respect for. He's the smoothest person in the sector. There we go. And this number's like, shut up and figure out the rare console. Look, I'll figure out this console at my own speed. Thank you very much. So I'm guessing this is going to be power. And then I bet that's voice going to like a mixer that's not present, but we can make it present. Sorry to bother you, John Luke, but as usual, you're the only ship in the quadrant. Why am I always the only ship in the quadrant? Don't we have other ships? What do we pay space tax for? Wait, I thought we were like a socialist community without money, so how do we actually pay tax? How does that work, actually? Stop asking questions, Jean-Luc, and go blow up aliens. That alien species has every right to survive. I'm Jean-Luc Picard. I turn into a completely different character once the movies start up. All right, the reason I'm removing this is just to double check the pin out just so I can see where everything goes. I had this very specific dream last night about a pair of pants. Like one of my pairs of pants. It was kind of like a dark, gritty, all-male reboot of the Sisterhood of the Traveling Pants. Okay, looks like we've got one going here and here. Okay. Hmm. You know, if I had to venture a guess, it might be the speech synthesizer and probably like a beeper booper. A beeper booper? You know? A beeper booper. Well, that's a separate connection. Oh, it's probably a different voltage. Interesting. Well, I should probably turn it on and see what voltages are there. And log it into my log. There's no indication that's even on. There's like no LED. Nothing. Just sadness. All right, 10 volts, and then that's another ground, so this is another test point. Interesting, negative 10 volts. Okay, here's the dealio. I'm gonna hook this up to my scope and then see if I see anything when the system turns on. And there's nothing. Kind of expected there to be something there. What if this thing doesn't turn on unless it sees the 11 volts coming back from the Laserdisc player over the cable? Does have that pinned out, as you can see by my amazing drawing.
I removed this connector to look underneath and double check, but yes, they are using the 11 volts. Oh, someone's gonna complain about my camera shaking. Oh, I don't care, zero production values. They are doing something with that 11 volt signal. Now I'll track that little bugger down all the way over here. It's going into the power section. I bet they totally did the thing that I think they did. Because something else I noticed, there wasn't any CPU activity either. Well, I guess the easiest thing to do would be to hook up 11 volts and see if it responds differently. I mean, really, how they're using that voltage to turn everything else on isn't as important as the fact that they are. You know, really, you know, all we need to know is that that is what they're doing. So I'm gonna try applying 11 volts and see if something different happens. That power supply is not plugged in. Okay, powering up the Halcyon. All right, same thing that happened before. Okay, now I'm gonna power up the 11 volt supply to that pin. Okay, something is happening. Okay, yeah, there's a Z80. The Halcyon looks like it's turned on by the 12 volt or the 11 volt supply from the Laserdisc player. So it's not using that to power the system. It's just using that to say, oh, the Laserdisc is on. So basically the Laserdisc is what's turning on the Halcyon. I've been present for the birth of every little creature on this island. Look, is it talking? Maybe it's like, push a button, I am Halcyon. Did you notice that the first three letters? Yes, we know it's Hal from the movie. Did you also know Hal is IBM if you switch every letter by one in the alphabet?
I got some computer speakers here. I hooked it up to what I believe is the speech pin. I don't know what the other pin does yet. Maybe it's for beeps and boops.
And to those of you who don't like overhead cam, let me be very frank. It's not about what's best for the viewer. It's about what's easiest for me. I spent 8 years having to do a higher production value show, so now I don't care anymore. All right, I'm gonna activate the power supply to simulate the Laserdisc.
Do you want to play Laserdisc?
Not really. I mean, there's really no reason to mix it with the Laserdisc audio. I mean, that's just a stupid gimmick. Probably the easiest way to quote unquote fix this is just have like a little headphone jack coming out the back so you can hook up computer speakers.
Okay, it's kind of hard to film all this. I'm gonna do the best I can. I don't have the microphone hooked up because it's probably completely pointless. I should be able to do it with this keyboard. Got the Laserdisc player, the TV, and the Halcyon. I have line one of the oscilloscope hooked up to that other pin. I'm guessing it's gonna be beeps and boops. We should be able to hear the speech from these speakers, and Laserdisc audio will come out of this, my beloved pawn shop television. Okay, so, all right, so Laserdisc player's off. I believe Fair's Quest is still in there. So let's power up the Halcyon.
Welcome to Halcyon. Do you want to play Fair's Quest?
Oh, I realized Laserdisc was already turned on.
Yes. Spell your name on my keyboard.
E.
E. N.
How do I enter?
Enter. Ben, do you like the sound of that, Ben? Yes, please insert the disc for part one of Sayers Quest.
How does it know the disc is in there?
Thank you.
Yes! It's the Halcyon, the greatest system ever! The Halcyon, from the Halcyon days of the 1980s.
Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall.
I actually have a chunk of the Berlin Wall upstairs on my desk.
Sayers Quest.
Do you want to make a voice print?
That sounds stupid.
No. Please use my keyboard to make entries.
Well, that's obvious. A bit rot adventure. That other line is at 0 volts. I'm going to set up a trigger on the oscilloscope to see if anything pops up on it. All right, begin game, introduction. Yeah, let's just begin the game.
One.
Oh, I don't want to fail the test of magic. Oh no, I'm dead!
Cost you a life. You have 2 lives left.
How am I supposed to know which one's right? Wait, no, I can't just put a jack on the back. I have to make it as close as possible as to what it was intended to be. You know, so the Halcyon engineers can finally rest in peace. I'm sure the engineers of this are like ghosts, and they're like floating around, and they're like, we will never be at peace. But now they can be at peace. It's like, we wear the chains we forged in life. I'll see how close I can get. Yeah, I figure I might as well make it as close to the original intention as possible. So I will have stereo input and output jacks, and then I'll just sum it with some resistors. Let's see, what's the best way to get those holes? I'm just making a very simple mixer with 4 10K potentiometers. It's probably going to go to an amplifier anyway, so I'm not too worried about the gain. So in this situation, we'll be using the potentiometers as variable resistors, not voltage dividers. I still wouldn't be surprised if there's like a thing that makes beeps and boops. Maybe I could try that NFL game. You know, I could try. I have both games released for this system. You know, I realize now, between the Nintendo PlayStation prototype, the Sega Pluto, and this, I have repaired the 3 most rare video game systems in existence. I don't know, is there something else that's that rare, like under 5 units? I'm not sure. Let me know in the comments below. Yeah, just slap that little panel in like that and hook up this connector and yeah, there she be. So no one will forget. And then 2020 has a sad face after it. So this would have been the original configuration. You have the audio coming out of the Laserdisc, going into the Halcyon, being mixed with the speech, and then going back out to your TV or stereo or whatever. Bud, you can't be in my workshop right now. This is the super rare video game system, and you're going to try to scratch it or chew it, and just because you're cute doesn't mean that you can do that. So I'm gonna lock you outside. I call it kitten jail, but really, I'm the one in jail.
Turn on the Legitus player.
Where's the speech?
Welcome to Halcyon. Do you want to play Sayer's Quest?
So I realize the problem with this system, at least with this screen, is this screen won't turn on unless there's a video signal present. So I plugged in my camcorder. And that's why we can now hear it.
Welcome to Halcyon. Do you want to play Sayer's Quest? Yes, spell your name on my keyboard. Please insert the disc for part one of Sayer's Quest. Thank you, Ben.
Okay, so now I'm going to unhook my camera. Hook video back into the Laserdisc. I unplugged the audio from the Laserdisc. Ah, there's that bit rot sound. Bit Rot Productions.
Do you want to make a voice print?
Heck no.
Please use my keyboard to make entries.
I'm gonna try it with my little Sony camera. See, my camcorder doesn't care if there's video or not. It'll just run whatever.
Yes, type in your name for me.
I am.
P-O-O-P-Y.
Why am I having such trouble with this keyboard?
P-O-T. Enter. Okay, but do you like the sound? Yes, please insert the disc for part one of Sayer's Quest.
So I guess you need a TV that will turn on whether or not there's a video signal present. So that's something that the owners will have to keep in mind. I noticed if you turn it on without a cartridge in, it says, please refer to the instruction manual for instructions or something like that. Okay, so I've got the cartridge in for Chargers versus Raiders. Turning on the Laserdisc.
Welcome to Halcyon. Do you want to play Chargers and Raiders football?
Well, of course I do.
Yes. Spell your name on my keyboard. C-E-N. Enter. Then was that okay then? No. Try a different spelling. R-S, enter. Rodgers, did I say your name right?
That's Rodgers. Right. I'm Aaron Rodgers.
Yes. Please insert the disc for part one of Chargers and Raiders football.
These overlays don't fit very well. Brilliant design job, guys. There we go. All right, so I forgot how big Laserdisc were.
If you go to the bathroom, Rodgers, please insert the disc.
Wait,
for
what did it just say about the bathroom?
Rodgers and Raiders football.
Was that like a joke? Wait, we have to try that again.
Welcome to Halcyon. Do you want to play Chargers and Raiders football?
Yes. Yes.
Enter your name, please.
F-A-R-V-E.
Enter. Farm. Did I say your name right? Farm.
That's not bad.
Yes. Please insert the disc for part one of Chargers and Raiders football.
There must be some sort of acknowledge on, well, there was an acknowledge signal on that line. That must be how it knows if the disc was put back in.
It might also be querying it for commands to see if the disc is in and seeing if it gets a pulse back. I want to hear that joke. Let's let it go for. Apparently, yeah, the cable.
Please insert the disc for part one of Chargers and Raiders football.
No, I'm so shy. But anyway, the communication cable on the back is basically uses the same format as a infrared remote control. It just doesn't have the 38 kilohertz carrier pulse to it. What am I cat get into now? Let's see if it says something else. That's funny. It's got all these randomized prompts. I don't know if you heard the first one, but it talked about how did you go to the bathroom or something? Okay, now the disc is in. Now this disc is in a lot better shape. I mean, it's still not great, but it's a lot better. Back in the 80s, the Packers weren't very good. Aaron Rodgers even alive back then? Wow, look at these graphics!
Welcome to the thrills and excitement of NFL football.
Do you want to make a voice print, Harm?
I wonder if the voice print actually works. I'm gonna try it. I'm going to plug in my headphone.
Yes. Please put on the microphone and repeat the words on the screen.
Farve.
Harv. Can you say harv?
Harv.
Repeat after me. Harv.
Harv! It also detected when I plugged in the microphone. Harv. That's interesting. Farv.
Say harv.
Say harv.
Say harv.
Harv. This part doesn't seem to be working. Can I abort out of it?
Repeat after me. Harv.
Harv.
Harm.
I don't think the voice recognition part of it's working. I picked Max as an
Max,
easier name.
Say Max.
Max. Windows.
Max. Can you say Max?
Yeah. It's trying to use voice sampling, but it's not working very well. But that's not a big deal because you can play the games with the keyboard anyway. No, I don't want to make a voice print.
No. Please use my keyboard to make entries. Do you want to be the Chargers?
Sure.
Yes. Do you want to play against me?
You're going down.
Yes.
Referee Cal Lepore, center of the field with the team captain.
Oh, no!
Ready now for the all-important toss of the coin. San Diego wins the toss.
I don't even get to call it?
Chargers have the ball.
They stole my agency.
And ball is on the 50-yard line. Chargers select offensive play.
Okay, how about a medium pass?
Medium pass versus contain.
Hobbs is back to throw. Comes out on the flat. Fine.
Yes.
Regains his balance. And out of bounds.
13-yard gain. First and 10 ball is on the Raiders' 37-yard line. Chargers select offensive play.
I'm gonna go with an end run.
End run versus blitz.
Bounce takes the snap. Hands off to Muncy on the sweep.
Oh, he's
the
wide open.
Blockers in front, turns the
yes.
Corner.
Oh. Down we go. He had pretty good protection on that play.
7-yard gain. Chargers select offensive play.
Okay, I'll put me on the 30-yard line. Let's go with...
go with a bomb.
Bomb versus Blitz.
Comes back pedaling to throw. Set.
Throw it already!
Gets hit and throws it. Deep in the end zone.
Oh, no!
Chargers select offensive play.
Okay, I'm going to go with a short pass.
Short pass versus Bremen.
Throws to Joyner in the
center. Oh, there we go. Yes.
Down he goes.
Okay, looks like.
18-yard gain. First and 10 ball is on the Raiders' 12-yard line.
It looks about right. I mean, it's probably more like the 13-yard line, but whatever. Okay, let's do a middle run.
Middle run versus contain.
Uh-oh, this might not work out so well for me.
The handoff to Capoletti, straight ahead, and he gets a couple.
Yeah, that's what I figured.
3-yard gain. Chargers select offensive play.
Let's go with another end run.
End run versus stack.
Cox takes the snap. Hands off Muncie on the sweep to the left. Turns the corner. Powers it.
Oh, no! He lost his helmet.
Chargers select offensive play.
Your player now has a concussion.
Short pass versus stack.
Cops barking signals, rolls back to throw. Looking downfield.
Throw it!
Ball in the air. Seavers can't hang on, incomplete.
Oh, come on. What? No.
Open. Chargers select offensive play.
Okay. End run.
End run versus stack.
Cops puts Winslow in motion. Near the goal line. On the sweep right, Muncie can't get away from the store.
No pain.
Shoot.
Raiders have the ball. First and 10 ball is on
what?
The 50-yard line.
The 50-yard line?
Select defensive
wait,
play.
That doesn't make any sense. So, I ran out of downs. No, did I run out of downs? How does that work? But they would be on. They wouldn't be on the 50-yard line. They'd be where the ball was. I'm confused.
Pass versus blitz.
Well, there you have it. The RDI Video Systems Halcyon Interactive Laserdisc System. One of the rarest video game consoles in existence. And it wasn't that it was broken. Rather, it was an incomplete prototype. But we added the jacks in the back, so now it works as intended as a pass-through audio device and Laserdisc control system. All right, well, I'd like to thank Richard for sending this in so I could take a look at it and figure out what was wrong. Thank you, Richard, for remembering me after, what was that, 19 years? Almost 20 years. So I hope you enjoyed this teardown. Look at this failed video game concept from the 80s. It's always cool to look at this strange stuff and see what's inside and, you know, make it somewhat functional again for people. Well, if you have any other rare things that you want me to fix, I'm mostly interested in fixing rare things, you know, so I'm not going to just fix random stuff. But if you have something, just email me at benheck.com and I'll see if I can take a look. And usually I just do it for almost no money. I mostly just like to make videos about it. But, you know, if you want to send me some beer or something, right? Well, almost no money plus return shipping. Return shipping's on you. All right, well, we'll see you in the next video.